Have your Bibles, like, for you to turn with me to Colossians, the third chapter. Before we do begin, I would like to have a word of prayer. We have some serious needs in our congregation. Betty Carroll has had it's a heart attack, heart failure, and she's in a very intensive part of the hospital right now, and there's a few of us that are struggling with allergies and head colds and things along that line that we don't want to equate to the more serious needs, but we still want to remember J.E. as he is in rehab and is progressing day by day.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
On his own?
On his own.
150 feet walking on his own. Pizza.
Because we snuck it in.
That a girl. Praise the Lord. And we would like for Brother Bucky, if you would, to stand. Just ask the Lord to be with us. Read the word, remain in the service.
Father God, I thank you so much for this day. I thank you for the praise, Lord, that has come forth from the many prayers lifted up for not just J.E., but the many others in this congregation that have had a need that has been met. Sister Janet, Lord God, Father, you just continue to marvel, Lord, us as humans, Lord God. But Father, there are other needs that you knew before the foundation of time that we lift up to you. This Betty Carroll, Lord God, the men and women that are touched by allergies, Lord, we just pray that you would heal them now. Lord, Father, first, we must come before you with a broken spirit and a contrite heart. And I pray that each one here today would present themselves, Lord God, in such a way, open, willing to receive the word that you have set before time for this day, Lord God. March 6th, 2011, you set aside time for us today. Let the word dwell in our hearts richly, that we might not be part of the 75%, Lord God, but Lord, that we would change that number, Lord God, with the word that comes forth today, believing by faith first, Lord God, that we can do that. You have called us to do that. Let the word dwell today in our hearts richly and give us ears to hear the word. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. You know, I heard that 75%, 25% thing over the past couple of teachings. And I want to say, let that 75% be somewhere else that we can be 100% here.
Right.
Yeah. I mean, words can preach all over the world. If they let that 75% go for worldwide at this hour right now. Yes. Let 100% of the people here hear what God is saying to this church this morning. I do want to say, wonderful job, Brother Ken. Amen. Let's give him a good hand. Continuing next Sunday, so if you missed it this morning, he'll recap a little bit and hit the ground running next Sunday at 10 o'clock. Also want to say our Bible study is meshing very well with what we're going to be talking about, and so if you do not frequent our Wednesday night Bible study at 7, it would benefit you to do so.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. Amen. Colossians, the third chapter, I want to set a golden text this morning for you to commit to memory and to heart. The Bible says here, beginning in the first verse, if ye then be risen with Christ, seek those things which are above, where Christ sitteth on the right hand of God.
Yes. Amen.
Set your affections on things above, not on things of the earth. Amen. For ye are dead, and your life is hid with Christ in God. When Christ, who is our life, shall appear, then shall ye also appear with him in glory.
Amen.
Somebody say amen.
Amen.
Amen. I want to talk to you about this portion of Scripture which says, set your affection on things above. You know, it doesn't take long spending time with any individual to find out where their affections are set. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. I've met all types of people with all types of different affections.
Right.
Amen. Some love the Lord Jesus with all their heart.
Right.
Amen. And you can tell it. And it doesn't take long spending time with an individual to understand that they love the Lord, that they want to talk about the Bible. Imagine that.
Right.
And I was struggling when Brother Ken asked in Sunday school, what is the first thing that a believer does? And he mentioned baptism, which is a very good answer. But I say, get a Bible. They all want to get a Bible. Amen? That's the first thing that you need to do, too.
Amen.
One of the first things. I don't know that either or, you know.
Yes.
Get a Bible, then go get baptized, or get baptized and go get a Bible. It doesn't take long to figure out when someone is in love with Jesus. Amen.
Right. Right.
Amen. It doesn't take long to figure out when someone is in love, period.
Right.
Amen.
Amen. And like some of you young men that are not married yet, you know, you go out and you try to find a young lady, and oftentimes there is a wall up because that lady's already in love with someone else. Amen.
Right.
And maybe she's engaged, and you might try to, you know, shuck and jive and make a move, but she's in love. You know, and nothing's going to change her mind. Now, there are some that are so sure. You know, so I just give you a little tip. It doesn't take long in spending time with anyone to see where their affections are. In our motorcycle ministry, we have a lot of different types of people, and some you can tell right away that they have an affection for their motorcycle. Amen?
Amen.
Yeah.
Come on, and sometimes that gets out of whack. For some people, it's cars. Amen. For some people, it might be reading. They love to read, and every time you see them, they have not only a book, but now they have the Nook. You know, you see. And it doesn't take long spending time with an individual to see where their affections are set. So, what I wanted to do is to help you be more like Jesus this morning in setting our affections on things above. And I want you to really grasp what that I'm trying to relay here. Let's go to Luke, the 9th chapter. This is Jesus in a situation here where that his time of ministering on earth was coming to a close. Many times people had tried to take him, but he, as the word says, would slip through the midst of them and would thwart their efforts to try to take him before his time. However, now the time had come that he would go to Jerusalem. And I want to read this scripture here from Luke, the 9th chapter, the 51st verse. It says, "And it came to pass, when the time was come, that he should be received up, he steadfastly set his face to go to Jerusalem." Now I want you to use a little bit of imagination this morning. And I want you to imagine someone with a one-track mind. Okay? They had a one-track mind. And Jesus was that type of an individual at this moment or juncture in his life. For a long time, 3 years or so, he had ministered to his disciples. He had performed miracles. He had listened to what his mother had to say or ask of him. And he had spent time with people. He had healed people and ministered to people. He had broken the bread and fed the multitudes. But now it was time to set his affections on things above.
Right.
And he would not be deterred from that moment in time. And he set his face to go to Jerusalem. Amen?
Right.
And so what I wanted to relay to you is to be like Jesus. We too must set our affections on things above where nothing else matters. Amen?
Amen.
He had something of a mindset that would not be bent. It would not be dissuaded. He was going to Jerusalem. Amen?
Right.
Amen. So much so, if you read this chapter in context, you'll realize that they were going through Samaria and they wanted to stay the night on their way to Jerusalem. But the way that Jesus looked towards Jerusalem made the people around him so uneasy that they didn't want him to stay in their village. So he found another village. Amen? Now listen, we'll come back at that. I've experienced a little bit of this myself. You know, a lot of people like to talk and things along this line. We'll have a Biker Sunday here in a couple of weeks where you'll see some people, hopefully, that you don't normally see here at church. They have their own churches and things along this line. But we had a Biker Sunday one time, and, you know, I have friendships that are outside this church circle. and we talk and we counsel with one another. And then this particular Sunday, we had a Biker Sunday and our friends were here and there was a lot of stuff going on. And as a pastor, sometimes you have to really keep an eye or an overview of everything that's going on because you don't want certain things to happen. Mm-hmm. Amen. Right, I'm just being honest with you. And so I have a one-track mind to be the shepherd for the day, you know. And so I'm looking around, and my friend said something to me, and I didn't pay him all the attention that he deserved. And he goes, "Oh, he's in the pastor's zone." Now, he knew that when we would all ride together, that we sat down to dinner, and we had one-on-one conversation, that I was with him 100%. But he also knew that when he stepped into this arena, that my mind was different. You see, and he knew by the set of my face that something was going on and that he didn't have the fullest of my attention because my attention was spread in a few different directions, but it was for one purpose.
Right.
Amen. Amen.
We must be people of that kind of purpose. Amen. You know, I want to really relate to you the depth of what Jesus was experiencing here because the drawing was so much more than just going for a visit to Jerusalem. This would be the time, this would be the road that would lead him to Calvary's Hill. This would be the time that he would be taken into the halls, judged according to men, crucified. And I wanted to take you a little bit through that journey, if you would progress with me to Luke the 22nd chapter. Luke the 22nd chapter and the 63rd verse, we'll begin there. This is in the halls of Pilate. When Jesus was betrayed by Judas, standing before men, and the men that held Jesus mocked him and smote him. And when they had blindfolded him, they struck him on the face and asked him, saying, "Prophesy, who is it that smote thee?" Mark 14 and 65 expounds on that just a little bit and says that they spat upon him while that they were doing this. I'm not sure that I would want to have walked down that road. I'm not sure that I would have been so excited to go to Jerusalem knowing what would befall me there.
Right.
But you see, Jesus had a different point of view, didn't he?
Yeah.
Amen? And that's what I want to be contagious for us, that we, as people of purpose, would see through the ordinary or the earthly to a heavenly purpose that would take us beyond just being another Christian or just being another religious person or just being another church attender. I want us to be people of purpose with passion,
right.
Amen, that will take us not only from where we are right now, but to where God wants to take us to.
Amen. Amen.
I admire Brother Kenny. He was talking mission Pakistan this morning. And for those of you that may not know, he has taken missionary efforts to Pakistan.